Is this a quality versus quantity kind of problem when it comes to making and shipping games? I think it's, but well, it's all quantity driven, right? Like people, well, it's both. I mean, it's both. I don't know. It's hard to make games, even for people who are good at it. Most people aren't that good at it because they're not that good at it. Or even if you are good at it, the mistakes you make it take longer and decrease the quality, and decreased quality also takes longer. I mean, people think of it the other way around. They think that, oh, making something better takes longer. That's true also, but there's like a saddle point where, like, if you fall below some level of quality, your development will take longer because just everything's a disaster, right? Making compiler is not the simplest possible way to program things, obviously. It's making a whole other language, it's the least simple way. Do you want to expound a little on knowing when to be simple and when to attempt something very not simple as a solution instead? What did I say the simplest possible way? Oh, you just mean, I don't think I said that a couple of minutes ago, did I? I mean, I do often advocate doing things the simplest way. I mean, you can apply this question at all scales, right? Like, okay, so, the last game we released was The Witness. That wasn't the simplest game to make, right? I could have simplified my life tremendously by making something simpler that probably also would have made a lot more money, right? I mean, the simplest thing at that point in time would have been Braid 2, right? And that would have made money. So, there is, I mean, in general, the way that I do stuff is there are certain changes that I want to make or see in the world, right? And I try to do them in the most effective way. And so when it comes to programming, when I say do things in the simplest possible way, it's not necessarily because there's extreme virtue in simplicity. I think there is some virtue in simplicity, right? We all know that from proverbs and things. But really, the reason I say that is because I mean, I'm trying to figure out because Casey asked this question. I'm trying to figure out the shortest answer. Like, I could go off on an hour rant here about how most programmers don't even know what they're doing and computer science isn't scientific. I know Casey probably at least generally agrees with most of what I would say, right? Like, most programmers believe what they believe about how to program is not really based on evidence in any way, right? It's just ideas that were communicated to them from other people on Hacker News, right? So and the observation that I have about that in the common case is that people are not being reality-based enough about what they're trying to do. And being reality-based in an engineering discipline means designing the thing that will solve the problem that you have, right? So what is designing the thing that would solve the problem that you have mean? It means, I mean, I almost don't know how to simplify it past that, but it means like, I mean, we all know that if you build a crazy Rube Goldberg machine that claims to solve a problem, or you do the direct thing that looks like it solves the problem. The direct thing is probably going to be simpler and more reliable and much faster to build and all these things. And so it's just to say that, like, almost all programming education is Rube Goldberg machines of some level or another. Some of it's good, but the aesthetic, let's not say education, let's say the aesthetic. The aesthetic of programming right now is very incorrect in the dimension of complexity versus simplicity, right? The aesthetic is, let's do this complicated thing because we can see how it builds a structure of how to program that we've been taught is exciting or interesting to think about. But if you really look at that structure very closely, it doesn't actually do anything with regard to solving the problem, right? In fact, it makes things worse sometimes, right? And I'm not just talking about something like object-orientedness. I'm talking about most things. Most paradigms of how to program are not reality-based in that sense, right? I mean, there may be more like mathematical ideas. I don't even mean like math, but like, oh, you should program in Python because blah, 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 right? It's like, if you're going to be like a mathematician and treat all potential combinations in space as being equally valuable, then that's an interesting thing to think about and whatever. But if you're an engineer who wants to solve problems, it's like, okay, wait, how does that actually apply to my problem? And not just in the moment, but like iterated over time and as you build up systems out of these things. And so it's just my advice to get back to the point. I'm not explaining this very well at all, which is why I want to get back to the point. My advice towards simplicity is just because, you know, I see all the time people not solving problems very well, and I see the reason why they don't solve the problems very well. It's because they become attached to some system of doing things that's overly complex and doesn't address the problem. So it's my attempt to shift programming culture in a direction that makes more sense and that's more effective, right? I wouldn't necessarily encourage people to do the simplest thing possible in the general sense, in terms of choosing what task to do, unless they're learning. Like if you're learning at the very beginning, it's good to do simple things. But when it comes to like most individual problems in programming are not that hard, and yet people spend months on them, right? And they end up with things that are way complicated, right? And there's this way that like programming is super linear, right? Like it's at least O n log n or O of n squared in terms of the way different things interact with each other. So if one piece is slightly more complex, then you get a super linear cost to that additional complexity, and that of course grows as those constants grow. I mean, one example of this that people were talking about, it came up on the frequent flyer Elite Lounge Discord channel. You know, someone posted a link to somebody's entity component system, right? I rant about entity component systems all the time. I say, you know, your game doesn't need one of those, right? As I always say, it makes sense if your job is to write an engine that you don't know how people are going to use it, right? Then you try to make this flexible thing. But if you're an independent developer and you know what game you want to make, just type the code for those entities, right? Like don't do a frou-frou component system because it's complexity that you don't need. Just one example of when I see people going out of their way doing stuff. Anyway, so what, I didn't even follow the link, or no, I did to the front page. I didn't read it up much about it, but somebody linked to a efficient multi-threaded entity component system that somebody like released on GitHub as their library, right? And I didn't even feel the need to read it because I just know it's not good. It's not the right thing. Why? Because there's this whole idea like, I'm going to make this component library. I'm going to make this library for threaded entity component systems, and that usefully solves the job of having threaded entity component systems. And then you'll come along and you'll build the rest of your game around that, and that'll be great. And that is never the approach that works, right? That's the approach that gave us direct show and shit like that, right? It's never good, right? What's good is you say, I have a particular problem. How do I solve it, right? What are the steps I can go to solve it, right? So if somebody made a game engine and it was high performance and it did a lot of good stuff and it shipped for real in multiple places and it was built around a threaded entity component system, then I would have more belief that that was valuable. It's still only valuable to people who buy into that whole engine, right? But that's the other, okay, the other thing I was trying to explain on the channel is like, look, it's super misguided to even start with that, because come on, a modern game, okay, what do? You read input, you simulate the game state, and you render, okay? Those are in order that they should happen in frame. They're also in order of how much they cost. Reading input is very cheap. Simulating your game world is, for most games, pretty cheap if you write the code well, right? Rendering is hella expensive. So having your game be high performance is almost always going to be based on rendering. You might say, well, what if I have bazillions of entities? Won't it take a lot of time to simulate those? And it's like, sure, it'll also take a lot of time to render them, unless your graphics are really shitty, right? So so the rendering is always going to dominate. And just like everything else, we have no allergy to complexity. So the graphics systems you have to deal with are heinously complicated, right? Which means the code is really complicated. It has to get even more complicated to be fast. And so if you're building a game engine for a modern game, almost all of the effort goes into rendering. And that sucks and it's stupid, but it's true. That's just what it is, right? And tasks related to rendering, like how do we, you know, load the assets and put them together on disk and compress them and all that, right? So because that's your problem, you want the structure of the engine to solve that problem, right? So if you have entities and some paradigm for how you call updates on the entities, you want the rest of the engine to dictate what that structure needs to be, because the rest of the engine is the part that's hard and complicated, right? And it needs all the help it can get in terms of being structured the way that it needs to be structured. You don't want to make it complicated because you have some weird idea about how entities should be. Entities is just calling some functions that do some code. That's been the same since like 1950, right? So starting with this idea, here's this threaded entity component system that's this beautiful package and you can use it and build your game around, it's completely wrong, because you have to shape all your things to plug into that. And that's not solving the problem that you have, right? So that's all. So what, if I could say in one phrase what I think is our problem is, we're not allergic to complexity as programmers, right? So programming culture is broken on a global scale, right? Cultures evolve over time. And, you know, more successful variants of a culture outcompete the less successful ones and spread better and all that stuff, right? Programming culture is new, and especially it's been growing explosively, right? And so there's been no selection pressure on it. And so it's super broken right now because anybody can believe whatever they want and there's no penalty, basically. There are mild penalties. Actually, the penalties for believing social things that are wrong think for the group that you're in are way, way steeper than the penalties for believing incorrect technical things, like facts that are not true about the world in the technical sense. So in that sense, there's kind of negative selection pressure, sort of, because if you're in industry, you're encouraged to be getting social decisions right and not engineering decisions, right? So that's super bad. Anyway, we just haven't, so because there hasn't been selection pressure on programming culture, whether or not you believe me about whether the current culture is right or not, you could at least expect that there's not that much reason for it to be right. There's like a very mild constraint that your program does kind of have to run, and that's a reality check, but that's getting looser all the time anyway. Like, look at how many more and more programmers are hired just to make a simple program run now, right? Like, people spend years at web companies working on individual web pages that are about the complexity of something I would program in BASIC when I was in high school in like a couple weeks or a week or something, right? It's just crazy at this point. So there's no... there's no pressure encouraging engineering or software engineering culture to converge on values that actually make sense and are true, right? And so I claim, and you know, there's some values that I believe that are more particular to me, and there are some that are more universal, right? Some that are more particular to me is I think it's stupid if you're wasting 99.99999% of your computer, which is probably not an exaggeration for most web software, for example. I think that's silly. Some people will say, well, whatever, it doesn't matter. The computer is really fast, right? But complexity kills everybody, right? It makes everything more complicated. It makes users unhappy. In multiple dimensions, because they have to deal with more complex things, and because the things work less well, it lowers the threshold of what we could even accomplish, right? All these things. So that's why, like, I think that if we do end up with some pressure back on the industry that pushes us toward some actual values that can be empirically verified in the universe, the benefit of simplicity will be one of the least controversial ones in the long run. In the short run, it'll still be controversial because all these people get paid to tell you to make things complicated, right? In the long run, no. I don't know. I feel like I've been very rambly, but not to discredit the point, but to follow up on what Binkara said earlier, this is all very easy to say when you've been programming for 30 years and not so easy when you're still learning and exploring and experimenting. Oh, I know. Well, okay, here's the thing. I feel bad for people who are learning in the modern environment because it's so screwed up. Okay, here's how I learned to program. All right. Up through about the fifth grade, I would go to grade school. I was not very happy in school, but I was like excited about math. I really liked math class and whatever. And then, or no, up through sixth grade. And then in sixth grade, we had our first computer class and I just loved it, right? And it was a super, I don't even remember that much of what we did in the computer class because it was really elementary. It was Commodore VIC 20s and they all shared one floppy disk drive. So at the beginning and the end of the class, the teacher had to go push one. It's like a bunch of physical toggle buttons and push one to connect computer one to the floppy drive and then you could load your program. And then push two to connect computer two to the floppy drive, and you could load your... So a lot of the class time was wasted on that, right? But it was very straightforward. It was like, you type these commands in the basic programming language, and then these things happen, right? It was a very simple, here's cause and effect, right? It was very not dogmatic, let's say. It was very not ideological. Then my parents, saw how much I was into computers and they bought a computer for home. And I was just glued to that thing every night after school for like years, right? And the first, when you bought a book or when you bought a computer at Radio Shack, right? That was just, that was the store they knew where to get a computer. They got a TRS-80 color computer, which was a pretty good computer. It wasn't as popular as the Commodore 64, but it was nice. And they had little books there about how to program the TRS-80 color computer. And those were great. You could blow through them at your own pace. And they were also very straightforward. Here's a command. Here's what it does. Here's an example of what you might do with it, right? Here's an exercise on how to expand your ability of what you might be able to do. And I just plowed through those. And at the end of those, I knew how to program. I mean, up to the standards of the day, not compared to today, right? But like, I could write non-trivial programs on a home computer, that were exciting and interesting and all that. And there was no BS involved in any of that. And it was very direct. And you even toward the end of those books started learning some actual things because you're in basic most of the time, but eventually it's like, hey, there's some registers that you can poke to control things like, how the video chip picks which colors should be up or whatever, right? And so you start learning how the machine actually works. So all that stuff was really great, and it's just not like that now. And so I feel bad for people who want to learn to program because everything that's being shown to them sucks. Like, it's all terrible. It wasn't terrible when I was learning, right? There was a lot of stuff that was less convenient. Programming in BASIC without a text editor was not that convenient, but there also was a way in which it wasn't crappy in the modern way that everything is crappy. Yeah, I don't know. I feel bad for people learning today because they don't have good examples. And that's one reason why I rant, because people need good examples, or else they're just going to think this is what programming is. And that's pretty bad, right?